Hello everybody, welcome to this VTU eShikshana program on cryptography, network security and cyber law. This is a part of your 6th semester course with course code 17CS61. I am Dr. Padmashree T. I work in the Department of Information Science and Engineering, RV College of Engineering. I welcome you to this course on CNS and cyber law. What we are going to do today is module 4 of the cryptography and network security syllabus. So module 1, 2, 3, I hope you have gone through and you have understood the basics of cryptography, the network security and other things. Module 4 is about wireless LAN security, viruses and worms, firewalls, intrusion, etc. As a part of module 4, let us see what is there in the VTU syllabus. In the VTU syllabus, as you see on the slide here, IEEE 802.11 wireless LAN security basics is, you will have to know about it. The background, the authentication, how confidentiality and integrity is maintained in wireless security has to be known. Apart from that, you have viruses, worms and other malware, wherein you will go through a set of concepts related to these things and how they affect our networking environment. In intrusion prevention and detection, we will see the difference between intrusion and prevention, how we can prevent intrusion, how we can detect intrusion. We'll see the clear difference between the two. What are the different types of intrusion systems that are available? What kind of attacks can happen over a system which is on a network? Then we will also talk a little bit about web security. What is the motivation to come up with technologies that support web security? What is WS security? We will talk about a very famous standard, which is the SAML standard, in detail as a part of web service security. Now we will just see which book we are using as a part of this course. This is the reference book which is VTU prescribed, Cryptography, Network Security and Cyber Law, which is authored by Bernard Menens as a part published by the Cengage Learning, the 2010 edition. The chapters for the module 4 are as I have shown here in red. If you can see it here, it is chapter 15, chapter 19 to 19.5, chapter 21, only two parts, 21.1 and 21.2, chapter 22, chapter 22.1 to 22.14, then chapter 25. These are the chapters which are there as a part of your syllabus prescribed by the VTU. Now for my presentation, for the content that I am delivering over this video recordings, all the content in my PowerPoint presentation and the delivery that I am going to give you is a part of the Cryptography, Network Security and Cyber Laws book, which is officially prescribed to us by the VTU. Okay, the Cengage Learning book itself is used. So the entire content is prepared from this book, because this is the book that you will have to study for your semester end examination and for your continuous internal evaluation also. So we are going to see the entire content from this book. I also want to let you know that I have used a little bit of web content wherever it is applicable for the entire module. If I think a more simpler version for explaining is required, I have taken the content from the web, and I have explained it as a part of the slides. So web content is also there along with the VTU prescribed contents. So now today what we are going to do is, we are going to start off our chapter with wireless LAN security. Just to make clear for you all, the wireless LAN security is chapter 15 of cryptography, network security and cyber law book. It is chapter 15. Okay, so we will start off with the actual content. Okay, now let us see that a little bit of background about wireless LAN security. Why is it a challenge? Okay, why wireless network security we have to study? We have studied wired security. We know how wired networks work. So why do we have to study wireless LAN security? And is wireless LAN security as easy as wired LAN providing a wired LAN security? No, it is a big challenge. But why is it a challenge? We will start. Okay, when you say wireless network, we mean to say that systems are connected to a network over a medium of communication. Correct? In wired LAN, the medium of communication could be your wires, right? RJ45 cables or network cables, it could be wires. But in case of wireless LAN security, the medium of communication is air. Now, what is the difference between wired and wireless? When you say it is connected by wires, what is the difference? What difference does it make? And when you say it is connected by air, what difference does it make? The big difference is that the wireless network is open. Wireless network is open. When the wireless network is open, it is easy to sniff the packets over the air. You will not even know who is reading the packets over the medium of communication. That is a big problem. Also, spurious packets can be inserted into this wireless network. Spurious packets can be inserted into the wireless network. Malicious packets without the knowledge of the networking systems can be injected. So that is a big challenge. For this wireless LANs, a provision of security is provided by 802.11 networks. The 802.11 networks, they do have security. Okay, but there are a little bit of flaws in wireless equivalent privacy, or what we call as WEP. We will see what are these flaws slowly and see how wireless network security helps in overcoming these flaws. Before we actually get into the structure of wireless LANs, we need to know a few terminologies. The terminologies that you need to know are, now first and foremost thing, you all would have heard of ad hoc networks. Now what are ad hoc networks? Ad hoc networks are mobiles or stations that communicate directly with each other. Okay, they are going to communicate directly with each other. What are infrastructure wireless LANs? Infrastructure wireless LANs are those wireless LANs that you may be using over your campus that makes use of an access point, right? We call the access point as an AP from now on. We will concentrate in this chapter completely on infrastructure wireless LANs. Wired network, when you say the Ethernet LAN with existing security infrastructure makes use of what is called as an AS. An AS is an authentication server. Okay, it is an authentication server. Like this, we have more abbreviations called the AAA, which is the authentication, authorization, accounting. These are the three functionalities that are provided to the infrastructure by RADIUS, RADIUS. RADIUS means Remote Authentication Dial-In User Service. Remote Authentication Dial-In User Service. So in many, many organizations, this AAA is the functionality that is provided by the RADIUS server. Okay, now our challenge is to seamlessly integrate the WLAN with security infrastructure of the wired network. Any organization for that matter cannot say is completely connected through wireless networks. You need to actually incorporate a wireless network as a part of the wired network. Okay, as a part of the wired network, and that's a big challenge. Now, we will see the next set of terminologies. You see what is called as BSS. Okay, a network of wireless stations. You have wireless stations. Okay, they are all associated with APs. AP means access points. Okay, a network of wireless stations are now associated with access points, and they are called as basic service set or BSS. Now, like this, there could be many different APs. Okay, why do you require many different APs? Because there could be many different networking stations across the buildings of the same organization. That is why there could be several access points. Now, all these access points, are they connected?
Yes, access points are also connected to each other. Access points of different basic service set infrastructure, they are also connected through the network. Okay, now this BSS consists of what is called as ESS. Or extended service set. It is called as extended service set. Now in ESS, there are so many different stations. Okay. Now every station and access point in the extended service set is identified by making use of its MAC address. What is a MAC address? You all remember that it is a 48-bit address. That is used at the data link layer to identify a frame. Okay. Now, the access point is also identified by what is called as SSID. SSID means, you can just see here, which is a 32-character service set ID. Now, with this background, we will now next see how the WLANs work. Okay, how the wireless LANs work. Now, why do you require that background is we are going to make use of all the abbreviations that we have used in the previous slides to see the working of wireless LAN. That is why we need to know the abbreviations. Now, for wireless LANs, when a wireless station, let's say, it's going to power up, a station on a wireless LAN is a wireless station. When a wireless station powers up, a nearest AP or the access point is searched for. It is going to look for it. Okay. Now, how is it going to look for it? It is going to look for it within its range. So this can be done by monitoring a frame, a certain frame, which we call as a beacon frame. A beacon is a frame which is periodically broadcasted by the access point. There is one access point. Periodically it will keep sending a frame which is called as a beacon. So when the station powers up, automatically when it acquires this broadcast by the AP, it identifies that this is the nearest AP to me. And then starts networking with the access point first. Okay. Now what is this access point? What does this beacon contain? This beacon basically contains the SSID of AP. Just to make you familiar with it, it is the service set ID. SSID of the access point. Now when the station reads the SSID of the access point, it is going to communicate with this access point and networking begins. Another form of a station associating with a wireless LAN would be to send a probe request frame. Okay, a station can send a probe request frame to look for any kind of an access point within its range. Any access point that receives this probe request frame will respond with the probe response frame. Probe response frame. So this frame now will have, whenever it responds, it has to respond back with the SSID of AP. When it responds back with the SSID of AP, now the station knows the identification of the access point and it is going to send a request to associate. Any station that has an access point ID will definitely not directly associate with the station. It is first going to request for an association by sending a associate request frame. Once an associate request frame is received by the nearest access point, based on its SSID verification, it is going to send back a associate response frame. Okay, once they are now associate, this is a handshake that is happening between the station and the associate and the access point. Once the station and access points are associated with each other, now simply the station can't start accessing the internet or accessing the network. The station has to undergo the process of authentication by authenticating itself to the access point. Okay, now 802.11 has clearly defined that every station should authenticate itself to the access point and then only associate with it. So for the association to complete, authentication is a requirement. What you see here is the infrastructure wireless LAN architecture. Now you're familiar with all the abbreviations, so it is now easy for us to understand what is the figure talking about. Okay, so in this infrastructure wireless LAN, you see two access points, access point 1, access point 2. They are connected to each other. Correct? That's what we talked about. And that becomes a BSS. A BSS service set 1 we have a BSS 2. We have two BSS. BSS 1 and BSS 2. A wired network is also connected to this wireless network. So the access point connects both the wired network as well as the wireless network. These two access points communicate to the RADIUS server. This could be a setup of one kind of organization. Okay, this could be the setup of one organization. Now we see that the stations, these are the stations. The computers that you see here are the stations. They communicate with the access points. These are another set of stations. They communicate with the access points. Access points are connected to each other through a network. The network is connected to a RADIUS server. Okay. So this is the infrastructure wireless LAN architecture. This is how it looks. Whatever we just went through, how it communicates, is all a part of this infrastructure wireless LAN. Okay, now let's talk. Now that we know how a wireless LAN looks like, let us talk about the security in Wi-Fi. The first and foremost protocol that had come up for security in Wi-Fi was Wired Equivalence Privacy. WEP. We call it a wired equivalent privacy. Now, what was the problem with this wired equivalent privacy? Why didn't we continue using this? This wireless equivalent privacy failed whatever it was designed for. It was designed for authentication. It failed on that ground. It was designed for data integrity. It failed on that ground. It was designed for confidentiality. And it failed on that grounds also. So it failed for whatever it was designed for, WEP. Therefore, WPA, Wi-Fi Protected Access, WPA was developed to fix the problems that the wired equivalent privacy faced with. Okay, so WPA came up with this solution to all the problems faced by WEP. 802.11i was the next version that came up after WPA. But why did it come up? It was because WPA was also susceptible to attacks. Attacks could happen on WPA also. 802.11 came up with another version of WPA called the WPA2, which addressed all the shortcomings of WEP as well as WPA, the first version. Okay, only WPA means WPA version 1. WPA2 has addressed all the shortcomings of WEP. Okay, 802.11i was implemented in WPA2. Okay, which addressed all the shortcomings of WEP. Now, this 802.11i, when it came up for wireless LAN security, it brought a drastic change on how to deal with authentication, integrity, confidentiality, etc. The whole point of how to deal with it was changed. Now authentication can happen. 802.11 is the earliest algorithm. 802.11i is the standard ratified in June of 2004. Okay, this 802.11i is a part of WPA2. It is a part of WPA2. Okay, early versions of 802.11, they had very naive approaches for authentication. Okay, pre-WP authentication was the early versions of 802.11 authentication approach. So they had name approaches, means what? Simply they used to use a SSID to authentication a station. Okay, if any station just had a SSID, it could be authenticated. Okay, now SSID, if a station has, if it can be authenticated, how safe is this? This SSID could be actually sniffed from the beacon or probe response very easily by an intruder. So if he has an SSID, he can actually get into the network just with the SSID. Correct? So that was a problem. Then MAC address restriction they added along with SSID. Now how long will it take to actually sniff a MAC address? If you have a sniffing tool, MAC address can be sniffed over a network, the list of all systems that are in the network, every system's MAC ID could be easily sniffed. Even that is not difficult. Okay, so these were the problems with the pre-WP authentication. Now, with WEP, what was the structure of authentication? So you can just see here. The structure of authentication looked like this. In authentication in WEP, the station is going to authenticate itself to the access point by making use of a challenge response protocol. What you see here is a challenge response protocol. Now, how does this challenge response protocol work? If you just see the statement here, access point is going to generate a challenge, and that challenge is nothing but a nonce. Okay, we call a challenge a nonce, a random number, anything, but that is a token. That is a token that the access point is going to generate, and it is going to send it to the station. It is going to send it to the station. The station is now going to encrypt this nonce. Encrypt in a sense, it is going to encode this nonce. If the nonce is 3251, it is going to make use of an algorithm to encode it and then send it to the access point. Access point. Okay. Then the street side, how is it going to use? What algorithm is it going to use for encryption? It makes use of the RC4 encryption algorithm, which you have studied in one of the previous chapters that is related to cryptography. Okay, so nonce is a challenge and encryption is done using the RC4 algorithm. Okay, now once received, the station is now going to compute a keystream. How is it going to compute a keystream? It is going to compute the keystream, which is a function of a 40-bit shared key S. A 40-bit shared key S with an initial vector IV. Initial vector IV is of 24-bit. So the keystream that is generated is a function of 40-bit, 24-bit identities. It is then going to XOR the challenge that is received with the keystream that it is generated and then generate a response out of it. Okay, now this response is going to be sent back to the station. Now this is very much better than just having a SSID or a MAC protocol. But what is the problem here? We will just see what is the problem. A possible attack on this authentication in WEP could be that any attacker could monitor the challenge response pair. He can compute the keystream by just doing an XOR. Once he gets the challenge response pair, he will have to just do an XOR. How does he obtain S? He can obtain S by eavesdropping on several challenge response pairs and thus do a dictionary attack on that S. He has a set of all challenge response pairs in his dictionary. So when he eavesdrop onto the network, he will get several challenge response pairs. And he can make use of his dictionary attack. Please go back and see what is dictionary attack. Okay, you will have to refresh the encryption algorithms for this part of the course, this part of the module. Okay, dictionary attack, and then he is going to obtain the S. Okay, no support for authenticating access point to the station with making use of this authentication in WEP. Even though we appreciated this WEP to be much better than the naive approaches that WEP was using before, but there is no support for authentication of access point to the station. Okay, so station to access point authentication, we all talk about, but support for authenticating the access point to station is not existing here. Now if that is not there, what is the problem? Any access point, now once you get the role, once an intruder or a rogue or a robber gets the role of an access point, he can attack or he can get access to all the stations, wireless stations in his vicinity. So access points can masquerade as an authentic one. Masquerade is they can behave as an authenticated access point. And when once they get authenticated as an actual access point, they behave like one. That is, they can perform any kind of an attack, including the man in the middle attack. Okay, so today what have we studied? Because this is the first class for module 4, we will just go back again and go through whatever we have studied so far, so that we are clear with the basics of wireless LAN, basics of wireless LAN security, its architecture, and the many different terms that we are going to see in the further modules. Okay, now we started off with why wireless LAN security is a challenge, how it is different from wired networks. We also talked about the flaws in WEP in the coming slides. Basic terminologies that are used in wireless LAN we saw, which are ad hoc networks, infrastructure wireless LANs, right? We saw what is an infrastructure wireless LAN, and throughout this module, we said that we are going to concentrate on infrastructure wireless LAN. To do that, we have to know a few abbreviations. AS means authentication server, AP means access point, AAA means authentication, authorization, accounting. This is a service. AAA is a service which is provided by a server which is called as the RATIUS, Radius Server, Remote Authentication Dial-in Use Server. Okay, Dial-in Use Server. Then we have seen BSS, which is the basic service set, network of all wireless stations which are associated with a certain access point is BSS. Okay, so access points of different BSS can also be connected through wire networks. BSS consists of ESS, which is extended service set. Okay, now station and AP in extended service set can be identified by its MAC address. AP is identified by SSID, service set ID. So how it works? By making use of beacon is one way that the LAN works. Another is sending a probe request frame. But pick both of them, beacon or probe request, they both are frames. They both are frames. So handshaking happens between the access points and the station, and then the station authenticates itself, which is a hard and fast requirement of 802.11. This is the structure, infrastructure. Wireless LAN structure, how it looks like and how are they connected to each other, how are the access points connected to each other, how are the stations connected to each other. Then talking about security in Wi-Fi, we saw WEP, which is wired equivalent privacy, why it failed, what happened to WPA. Then how did 802.11i come into picture, and what change it brought in security for Wi-Fi. We started off with the authentication part. Before WEP, how was the authentication happening, and how was the authentication happening with WEP, we have seen in detail. Then even with the authentication with WEP, even though we claim that it is much stronger than your pre-WEP authentication, still it is prone to attacks. So these were the various kinds of attack that could happen. So if somebody is monitoring a challenge response pair, so he can just XOR it and compute the keystream. Once the keystream is obtained, he can get OS by eavesdropping on challenge response pair and doing a dictionary attack. There is no support for authentication of access point to the wireless station. Then any rogue access point or intruder access point can masquerade as an authenticated access point, and he can perform the man in the middle attack. Okay. So this was the basic knowledge that is required for wireless security. And what we will do is, in the next class we will go into detail of wireless LAN security, how handshake happens, etc. In detail we will see how security is given to the wireless networks in detail. Till then, kindly revise the cryptographic algorithm, because The wireless security protocols make use of encryption, and encryption is a part of your cryptography. So there are many algorithms that you have done in your module 1, 2 and 3. So just refresh with those algorithms and we'll go into detail in the next class. Thank you very much.